Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to the Hit Back. I'm your host, Nahaja Black. It is a beautiful day here in the 242. I hope that you are doing well, that you are taking care of yourself, that you are living your best life possible. I'm excited about this week, y'all, because this week is Natural Resources Week. It is no other week like it. No other show has done it the way we're going to be doing it on the Hit Back, because we believe in our natural resources. We don't just believe in it. We know what it is. So much so that I am a part of a wonderful foundation, one of the founding members. You could call me one of the founding members of this wonderful foundation, the Bahamas Natural Resources Foundation. And it was one of our plans to always show how much information is out there, how much information needs to be shared with the Bahamian public when we talk about our natural resources. Today, I'm very excited about the conversation we're about to have, because I don't think I've heard many people have it. And so it's getting me really excited. We got some really brilliant, good-looking men joining me on the show today, which is rare. I won't lie to you. I get a lot of fellas, but they all three together are good-looking. That's a challenge. That never happens in real life. So then, you know, I think they're all taken, though. So sorry, ladies. I'm just, maybe not. Maybe I'm overselling. I might be saving some of them the heartache of dealing with some of us, but we digress. This ain't the show. All right. So I'm excited to be today. We are talking about seaweed as a resource. So let me welcome my esteemed guest. Of course, you know, Aj, the chairman, the illustrious chairman of the Bahamas Natural Resources Foundation. Aj Cunningham is joining us. And then we have all the way from, I would say Scotland Yard, but that would be wrong, all the way somewhere in the UK. I think it's London. I think
it's
London.
Not quite London. Deepest, darkest was right, I would say.
We have Mr. Fred Puckle Hobbs joining us on the show. And then all the way from somewhere in the greatest country in all of the world. Sorry, Fred. Dr. Delavaux, and he's going to pronounce his first name for me to make sure that I didn't screw it up. And because I did a show with Aj the other day, and I almost had to marry an African because I was about to say his name wrong twice. So I'm not going there, Dr. Delavaux. Welcome. Yes,
good afternoon. It's Valier Delavaux.
That's where I was going. I was going to say Valier. I was going there. I wasn't going to have to give you a chicken, a goat, or have to deal with marriage proposals. So God is good.
Yes.
Welcome, guys. Thank you so much for joining me on the show. It's a pleasure.
Pleasure to be here.
Pleasure to be here, definitely.
All right. Well, as you know, this is one of our babies together, trying to get this information out. So I'm always excited when we get to do it. And with Aj Cunningham, another brilliant Bahamian doing great things with the foundation, chairman of the Bahamas Natural Resources Foundation. Aj, you lead the way with this topic today.
Yes, so Nahaja, I was doing some research and I came across some information regarding seaweed, and particularly sargassum seaweed, which is in this area of the world. And over the past 10 years, this has been an abundance of growth of the seaweed in the waters of the Caribbean. Particularly, we have the Sargassum Seaweed Commission for the Sargassum Sea, which is Saragossa Sea, which is in by Bermuda. So I did some work and I realized that seaweed, normally when you think of dishes, seaweed, you're in the Asian or the African culture, but you never really hear that in a Caribbean diet. So, but I come to find out that through my research was that this is a burgeoning area. And when we look at the natural resources within the economic territory of the Bahamas, we have seaweeds. And for us, most Bahamians think of seaweed as a nuisance on our beach. It goes contrary to our ecotourism. So it's something we want to get rid of. So I said, well, it is a natural resource, but is there value? Well, it turns out that there was value. And I went through a symposium, the World Ocean Summit, and I met Mr. Hobbs and found out that he's part of an organization that's located in Asia, in Singapore, which is a growing international market in that area. And the subject matter, how do you turn this into a viable industry? As you know, the foundation, we are for the protection, the economic viability and the ecological sustainability of natural resources of the Commonwealth, of which the Bahamian citizens are a primary piece, and how do we empower them into the Bahamian ownership model? It is not a big area right now, seaweed in our part of the world, although some countries, i.e. Jamaica and others, have started, have the lead on us. So from the foundation perspective, I said, let's start to educate the Bahamian people. I really have a conversation around this new potential industry and see what can we hold for our islands of beautiful flora and ocean marine life. So I met Mr. Hobbs, and so he's the operation manager for Sea Green, which is based out of Asia, but also they have teams in Asia as well as Europe, UK, for example. And through that, from relationships working with BAMSI, the Bahamas Agriculture and Marine Science Institute, met Dr. Delavaux, who is a marine scientist, mm-hmm. who understands the dynamics of the marine life and the education and also the viability that can sustain. So therefore, I want to thank you for this opportunity to bring this to the Bahamian public and bring this awareness. And just as a footnote, all the information that we'll have and some additional documents will be available on our website for the public to really look and to get more in-depth understanding of different compositions of our conversation today. So I'd like to welcome the gentleman, and I'll thank you, Nahaja, for allowing us to bring this to the Bahamian people.
Well, I mean, as I tell you, that was one hell of an introduction, because now I'm really excited to just dive into the conversation. Well, first off, let me just say to my guests, thank you guys so much, because this is going to be a wonderful learning experience. And Dr. Delavaux, I must say, forgive me that we are just meeting to have such wonderful resource within country. And I have yet to meet such a stellar Bahamian. So forgive me. And this is our first time meeting. And I blame it on Aj Prescott, your brother. I blame everybody else. I blame everybody. I just wanted to be known. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Foot to the fire. Feet to the fire. All right. So then let's talk about this. Because Aj is right. When I think about seaweed, it isn't until recently. I mean, I won't lie to you. This is just a foul-smelling grass that gets in my feet. Because, you know, I can't swim. As a Bahamian, so I have to walk on it, right? It's the most uncomfortable, grossest thing, and it stinks as it dries on the shore. But apparently, it has value, not just in the intrinsic economic value, but that it is essential for the health of our oceans. And so I want to start with you, Dr. Delavaux, leading this conversation from the sense of the Bahamas as it stands, its archipelagic nature, its marine diversity. How important is the seaweed to our biological existence, our marine environment?
Okay, thank you very much, Nahaja. First, I'd like to start off with a brief overview.
Please.
Seaweed, as you said, we think of it as a pest, a nuisance. But as a marine brown algae, it is a brown algae that grows naturally in the wild. The marine environment produces at least 50%, sometimes depending on your source, it's even more of the oxygen we breathe daily, of the oxygen produced in the air that we breathe. The marine environment produces a large quantity of the oxygen we breathe through the plankton, through seagrasses, through the seaweeds. They all help us to breathe. So it has an important role there. Then moving on locally, we have to look at, yes, when it's abundant and it does wash ashore, it is a pest, but it's a natural habitat for many, many species, whether they be fish, crayfish, different species that when they float or in their fronts, it's a natural habitat for many species, some of them economically important to us. Some of our pelagic species, tunas, tarpon, some of the wahoos, wherever they are natural resource and a natural habitat for many species. So we benefit from them that way as well. Whether they are attached to the bottom as they usually are, or they're floating mats. They become natural fish aggregating devices when they are floating free in the ocean. So again, benefiting us as humans. So there are many, many roles seaweeds play. And then there are many uses. Most commonly, our farmers go to the beach, pick up the seaweed, and put it on their farm as a natural fertilizer. After they wash it and cleanse it of the salt, they use it to fertilize their fields. I mean, that's just one of many uses, but probably the most common use we know. And throughout the Caribbean, as Mr. Cunningham noted, it is used in many ways, in pharmaceuticals and drinks, we know. And us in the Caribbean, we tend to have superstitions, and it's an aphrodisiac in some cases. So, hey, anything to get promoted, there you go. That's what
that aphrodisiac for Bahamian men is a real thing. I don't know, Fred. I don't know what's going on in your side of the world, but everything for Bahamian man is an aphrodisiac. Cardboard, whatever it is, we'll mark it.
I can't say that rumors reached Asia yet.
Okay, so, and you said, what did you say just now, Dr. Delvo? Irish moss?
Yeah, it's a seaweed. Yeah, made from a seaweed.
Really? I know. Can I just say this as the lone female on the show, just throwing this out here. How is it that men can try going into pharmaceuticals to save themselves from a heart attack and come out with a blue pill? How is it we found out? Just curious. I mean, I'm just going to throw this out here. We know that Irish moss is an aphrodisiac. Who came up with that? But we digress. This ain't the show. I tell you guys, thank you, though, for this ain't the show. Fred, your thoughts, again, from Sea Green, tell us a bit about Sea Green, the company, and so that it gives context to also your skill set and expertise in this area.
Thanks, Nahaja. It's a real pleasure to be here, by the way. Thank you so much for inviting me on. And I was very, very happy to meet Arj, as he said, at the World Ocean Symposium. And it's great. I think probably the first thing I'd say is that what I've found since working in this area is the amazing ability of the community that works on seaweed to come together to make this a reality for people in the world. From my side, my story is a bit of a strange one with regards to seaweed. I think probably the biggest mark of the industry is, as we know it right now, it's not hugely widespread, and a lot of people don't understand the potential of seaweed. And for me, about a year ago, I was one of those people. I knew that it was an important thing. I understood that it was very, very prevalent in marine environments and marine ecosystems. But until I started working with Seagreen and until we started running this operation, we didn't really quite fully understand the potential. And right now, from my perspective, I think it couldn't be more important. And we're seeing that the world over, from the UN to the World Bank to the development banks as well, globally, they understand that this is a crop that's going to be really, really important for the next decade as we head into this decade of climate action. And I think even just saying that sort of indicates how important it's going to be. And Dr. Delavo already listed some of the uses, but we're just starting to find out some really, really fascinating things. And Seagreen really comes out of the desire to use seaweed and coastal ecosystems in a restorative, regenerative way to help develop coastal communities. Our overall business, the business which Seagreen is a part of, was initially looking at coastal cooperatives in northern Java, Indramayu in Indonesia, and looking at the power of coastal organizations to work together to use things like fishing and the profits from fishing collaboratively to run coastal community initiatives. So they visited a particular town, and in that town they were running a local school, local hospitals, a couple of other key infrastructure services through the profits from shared fishing. But the issue was, a lot of the methods used to catch these fish and the locations were unsustainable. So they were using illegal netting, illegal catch, those kind of things that really wasn't a sustainable way to proceed with these operations. So we turned to the idea of what we could do alternatively, and we suggested that potentially seaweed was an option. And seaweed is a huge commodity in Indonesia and indeed in Asia. And obviously, as we all know, it's a key part of a lot of Asian cooking. And as you said rightly, it doesn't really spread elsewhere, or at least it hasn't yet. But actually in Asia, it's a hugely important industrial commodity. So there's two particular types of seaweed that are grown extensively in Southeast Asia and in China, and that makes up about 90% of the world's commercial seaweed market. So the suggestion was, why don't we start looking at how we can use sustainable seaweed farming as a way to basically to improve the livelihoods of these coastal communities? Well, what did that actually mean? Well, there's a few elements to it. Obviously, that means making more money, and that means being able to support these communities as they grow. But really, we have to make sure that we're engaging with these communities in an educational and indeed financially inclusive way. So that means making sure that they understand how to do things better in their operations and also understand how to engage with the economy, especially the banking world, so that they can support themselves from a financial perspective, savings and loans, those kind of things, but also protection like insurance to make sure that they're not going to be affected negatively by things like tragically, the Indonesian tsunami or the Southeast Asian tsunami in 2004, which I think we can probably liken very, very closely to the events of Hurricane Dorian in 2018. Very, very similar story. So a lot of destroyed communities that need this increased earning potential, but also this protection. So how do we're going to do this? We're going to look at a way to bring this education and these improved livelihoods to these communities. Well, probably the best way to do that is through technology, to engage, to make sure that we're still staying in touch with these communities. And we can do that through mobile. These days, things like blockchain, mobile technology will make it very, very easy to reach these communities and to support them in the way that they grow these businesses. And lastly, this also gives us the opportunity to measure the impact on them. So really what Seagreen is about is taking all of these ideas and pulling them together into technical assistance, but also a technological platform and other community organizations on the ground that really, really help to build this framework of empowerment for the coastal communities. And we work with another organization in Indonesia called Mari Oceans, which has recently been awarded, or is one of the first winners, I should say, of an innovation challenge for the Ocean Risk and Resilience Action Alliance. And the idea is that between Seagreen and Mari, we hope to be able to export these models that we develop in Southeast Asia further across the country and then the region and then hopefully the world. And I think that's why we're here today to spread that message, to show what we can do with these communities, what we can do with these models, what we can do with seaweed to help people globally.
You know, again, if you're just tuning in, you're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black Guardian 96.9 FM. And we're talking about seaweed as a resource. That was Fred Puckle Hobbs joining us, Dr. Delavaux, as well as Ash Cunningham on the show with us. Okay, gentlemen. So now that we've set the context, the pretext of this conversation, right? I have a few questions. All right. And Dr. Delavaux is quite aware. Ash is familiar. Fred, you'll get to know me soon enough. I always got questions because I don't know much, so I ask a lot of questions. Seaweed as it stands, and from what both of you have said, and what Aj, all three of you have said, is that obviously there is an economic, an intrinsic economic value to this thing, right? As someone who has studied economics, international political economy, I'm always trying to figure out how to be sustainable in growth and in development at the same time building a nation, right? So how do we do that sustainably? How do we take advantage of abundance without causing a vacancy or a vacuum from greed, right? So striking that balance. And I wonder, for the Bahamians who are listening, and in a time of a pandemic, everyone is trying to figure out, how do we pivot, right? Dr. Delavaux, you know this, as a Bahamian, as a scientist, there's always that question or this line that we have to walk. How do we pivot? How does a Bahamian view seaweed as an economically viable resource? And still, we don't have to worry about the foundation coming on top of their heads and saying, you devils, how dare you destroy the oceans? How do we, are we able to do this? Do we have this amount of resource?
Well, certainly. Right now, there have been several persons expressing interest in farming seaweed. It is a natural resource. It is available locally here in the Bahamas, and it's simply in the wild. However, we locally have not put as much use to it as it's been commercialized in the rest of the Caribbean, in Jamaica, in Barbados, in St. Lucia. There are commercial entities that are producing it, farming it for multiple reasons, whether it be for simple use simply as drinks, whether it's in the pharmaceutical industry, you know, whether they've been making paper out of it. You know, there are multiple uses. Fertilizer. I mean, over the last, say, 5 to 10 years or so, there has been a serious outbreak of sargassum in the region. And it's been piling up feet deep for miles and miles of basically tourism economy beaches, which wrecks their tourism industry to some part. Make people not want to come when the beach is no longer there. It's covered in algae and you have to spend a lot of resources to remove it. I mean, it's being done in multiple ways in the different countries in the region, but again, it is an issue. But so what they've tried to do is make lemonade from the lemons they've been given. So they've multiplied their facilities that they needed to convert the products, the waste products, into something useful. So their industries have expanded. They're finding new ways to grow it. And they're even turning to farming it. There are programs to teach farmers to farm it product throughout the region now in the Caribbean. The United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization has offered courses in some of the countries to teach locals how to farm it in a proper way, the correct species to farm, the species that are useful and can have useful products made from it. So in the Bahamas, we haven't paid much attention to it because, we, as far as I'm aware, have not had the serious problems the rest of the Caribbean has had here in the Bahamas in terms of that, because we don't see, I mean, yes, during winter, during the storms, we will have some seaweed wash up, especially sargassum. But there are other products that can, there as well, other seaweeds, sea mosses, different algae that can be farmed. But certainly we haven't had a problem, so the opportunity really hasn't been there, but it is there on a not as expansive scale as in the region, but certainly it is available here.
Well, what is the cause of that, if you don't mind me asking? What's the cause of, I'm sure the science has figured it out by now. Is it global warming? Is it, you know, we killed all the sharks? I don't know.
That is one of the questions I think is still being determined. There have been population of global warming is part of it, increased nutrification of the environment, especially near land, with all the runoff coming off offshore is a serious problem. Once that happens, certainly you get algal blooms. There'll be multiple reasons, but I don't know if they've nailed down a specific unit cost, you know, what has caused for it, but maybe Mr. Hobbs may know a bit more.
Yeah. What do you know, Fred? I'm going to you.
Well, I think there's a multitude of different reasons, and we're seeing more and more these days further kind of research being played out in popular TV. Things like the recent Seaspiracy documentary talks a lot about the effect of certain types of industry on our oceans. And certainly it's true that acidification, temperature increase are all contributing factors to the changes in our environment. But I think one of the really key elements of this that's important to understand is that seaweed can actually be used as a tool to fight this problem. There's compelling evidence to suggest that not only can seaweed help reduce the acidification of our oceans, which does things like kill coral reefs, make it very difficult for certain species of animal to survive, but it also can be used as a direct method of sequestering carbon back into the ocean. And as we know, carbon dioxide is very, very much absorbed by the ocean. It's a huge, huge quantities. In fact, probably I think it's 60 to 70% of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is absorbed by the ocean and continues to be every year, significantly more than the land population, the land flora in that sense. So it's really important that we understand how seaweed, macroalgae can be used to sequester this carbon back into the ocean. Admittedly, still quite a young area of research and something that's ongoing, but definitely an area that we at Seagreen are very, very interested in. And a lot of the research focuses on seaweeds like kelp, the brown seaweeds, which grow very, very quickly and can be introduced into natural environments, especially in Europe and North America. But these brown seaweeds, these red seaweeds, all have a value that needs to be understood in this respect. And we're very interested in another type of seaweed that has been studied quite extensively recently, called Asparagopsis. And recent studies have indicated that this particular type of seaweed can also be added as a supplement to cattle feed to reduce the ruminant methane emissions that come from cows in processes, I'm sure you can guess, to reduce those emissions by up to 90%. So this could be something that could be very, very well integrated into the agricultural value chains to reduce their impact on the natural world. There are so many uses for seaweed, and whilst it may seem like it's a symptom of a degrading natural world, it's also probably the solution.
Oh, that's good. I like that. Because then it's a hopeful proposition, right? Dr. Deliver, you were going to say something there?
He's correct. Very much so. One of the things I like that happens in Asia is that basically nothing goes to waste. Here, we still have a more Western idea of if we can't find immediate use for it, chuck it, you know. And over there, it seems like there's a use for everything. It's recycled much more than we have. Tend to have more of the more developed attitudes. Mm-hmm. We can't find a use for it right away. We want it now. If it doesn't give me some return on it immediately, let's move on to the next thing and again use up more of the resources that are available rather than trying to recycle and redevelop or, you know, get additional returns from the products that are available to us. I mean, we do live in a finite world. People can't seem that the ocean is finite. People think it's so huge, we can't run out of it. I mean, clearly fisheries have shown that this world is very finite. We have, I mean, depletion of many, many resources that people took for granted could never be depleted as little as 40, 30, 40 years ago. A lot of people thought these resources couldn't be used up. We could take as much as we want without consequence. Now we know better because our capture fisheries has been constant on a steady for the last, I don't know, 50 years. There have been really no increases, but aquaculture has been booming, increasing by far. More than 50% of our food we eat now, especially seafood, comes from aquaculture. People don't realize that. And more and more is being done because the resources we can obtain, is stagnant, really. We're not getting any further increases. Even shifting to additional stocks, we're not getting any additional increases. So we have to find some way to continue to produce more to feed the growing world population.
Yeah, no, and that's a powerful statement there. Aj, before we go to break, your thoughts?
Yeah, no, I just think probably after break, Nahaja, I think when you look at the best part about this is from the Caribbean and Asia and what Fred is bringing in terms of models for coastal communities, we have an advantage here in the Bahamas where we can start to explore what this market will look like. How do we empower Bahamian people to go into aqua farming of seaweed? And the model exists. And then one thing I would like to know on the other side, perhaps from Fred, is what type of cost of capital? What does that business model look like for the small family farmer or fisherman to enter this marketplace?
Yeah, and I agree. That's where we're going to jump off on the other side. Now let's look at the models. Let's look at how do we take advantage of it. And for those who weren't able if you're listening on the radio and you're not watching live or watching it on YouTube, there was a video that I was playing in the middle there that was showing an explosion of this sargassum seaweed in Jamaica. And well, the first thing I noticed, apart from the large mounds of seaweed, gentlemen, is just how much plastic was in this seaweed. That already has me all emotional already, just from an environmental standpoint. And it made me wonder, we all share the ocean, right? So should I be concerned, Dr. Deliveau, that our sea looks that terrible as well? Is our sea...
We can't escape the dirge of plastics in the ocean. There's no way we can escape it. Even on the most isolated islands anywhere in the world, you find tons of plastics washed up ashore. And people, we all talk about the great garbage patch in the Pacific, but there's nowhere on this globe we can go without finding plastics, man-made plastics everywhere. Plastics is one, other waste products. The sea has been used as a dumping ground for years and years and years. And You don't want, you like it out of sight, out of mind. And that's been a problem. And it has impacted our fishing, our communities, the whole coastal resource. I mean, even in the deepest part of the oceans, in the trenches, you're finding human garbage.
Now, this show should have come with a nice glass of wine. That's after seeing this video, I'll tell you that. All right, gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, let's dive into it. Let's talk about it from the economic standpoint. What are the models? Fred, I want you to give us an idea of how Seagreen's model is workable in an economy our size. And of course, you're in Singapore. I don't know if Singapore's not small in its economy, small in its size, but not small in its economy. So let's have a chat on that too. And then Dr. Delavaux, from the vantage point of sustainability for us, I would really like for us to drill in economics and the sustainability side of it as well. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Everyone, please stay tuned. Don't go far. We'll be back right after. And we're back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. All right, everyone. If you are just tuning in, it's been a very educational show so far. We are talking about seaweed, y'all. Seaweed as a resource, a national resource, a treasure. We are, you know, I still don't like the way it looks or smells, but if money's in it, boo, that's grass gold to me. I will go on the beach today. As I pick up plastic, I shall be, I don't think that's what you do. I was going to pick up a bag of seaweed, but one part of me said, no, Nahaja, something's wrong. How I was thinking about it just now, I felt like I was breaking all kind of rules. But we shall see. We shall see. Joining me now, we have these wonderful guests that are with us. We've got Fred Puckle-Hobbs all the way from Seagreen, the company Seagreen. Fred, just to make sure, where are you again?
I'm actually in the UK at the moment, but normally I would be in Singapore. It just so happens I'm in the UK right now.
Gotcha. So Fred is in the UK. Thank you, Fred. Whatever the time difference is, I'm sure Aj is paying you well. I thank you so much. we have our very own director of marine science for, is it Bamsey? Dr. Dalla?
Yeah. Bamsey, yes.
Well, see, listen, I tell you guys, that's why, you know, you think Bamsey ain't doing nothing, but we got a whole marine director, a marine scientist. And if you saw him, you would know exactly who his family relation is. Or if we saw now that I've seen Dr. Delavaux, I realize now that his brother, I don't even know how that happened, Dr. Delavaux. I feel for you. I do. I'm just going to let Jeff know that I feel for you, not for Jeff at all.
Everyone has their purpose and their calling.
Part of that felt a little shady, Doc. I will say that. Just a tinge of brotherly shade. And then we have, of course, the chairman of the Bahamas Natural Resources Foundation and a friend of the show, a friend of the Bahamas, Aj Cunningham. Guys, thank you so much again for joining us on the show today. Let's talk money now. Right? If I could play that clip, money, 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 that's what I would play. But my producer ain't here, so I just had to play it, sing it myself. Let's talk about money. The money or the economic turnaround valuation of seaweed. Fred, this is in your wheelhouse, right? This is your wheelhouse. So that is one of the reasons why we have you here. I am looking at a small economy like the Bahamas. And when I say small amount of people, but I don't believe that it means the weight that it can push back into the world with our natural resources. How do you guys account for, measure seaweed? You know, is there some sort of science, economics, some sort of money science that tells you where to go, how to do this thing? I'm in.
I mean, I guess I wish it was that easy to boil it down to a simple number. But and in some ways it is, I guess. I mean, I can tell you straight away that the commercial seaweed market globally is worth about $60 billion. So it's a $1 billion industry, right? It's got a lot of money in it and it's growing
today.
Fast. Oh, yeah.
Today. $60 billion.
Well, 2019. Yeah. $60 billion.
Wow.
And by 2026, it's meant to be $85 billion, which says a lot for how fast it's growing.
Yeah.
So in the next 5 years, it's growing, you know, like 12% a year. It's a big growing market. And we know that aquaculture is a huge part of the global economy. And again, that's a massive market. And the really, really key part of why seaweed is going to be such an important part of the next 10 years is it's going to underpin that sector. And it's, as I say, it's a huge growth market, aquaculture, and a lot of that is fishing. But we want people to see the value of looking at other crops in the ocean. And seaweed as a resource is going to be, as I say, a huge part of that. But coming to the kind of economic element of this for the individuals, I think the piece that's easiest to understand is that this is something that anybody can do. In Indonesia, where our primary partners grow the seaweed, I think you don't need much more than a boat and a piece of water effectively to start growing this stuff. We work with communities in a particular part of Indonesia called South Sulawesi, and there are established communities of seaweed farmers there who've been doing this for 20, 30, 40 years. And this is something that's been supporting livelihoods in that area to the point where it's a really established industry. There are 220.
Hold on. Sorry, finish that number there because I had a question, just jumped to mind. 220,000
seaweed farmers in Indonesia, more than 220,000.
Holy, wait, okay, all right. Now the wheels are turning, right? Okay, so we're talking about seaweed farming. You're saying, Fred, we plant our seaweeds. We're planting seaweeds, right?
That's correct, yeah.
How? What is it, like a seaweed seed? What am I doing? I'm sorry. Dr. Della was like, yeah, that's why we're doing this show, because we have no idea what's going on.
It's understandable, right? I mean, it's funny because you do actually have seedlings for seaweed. It is true. But a lot of the time people just cut off the seaweed, you know, like a cutting, and then you go and put it back on your lines and you restart the process. So a lot of seaweed is grown on these lines suspended in the water. That's one way of doing it. But you have multiple methods. You can use off the bottom planting. So you put the seaweed directly into the seashore or the sea bottom. You can also grow it on mats, on platforms. There's lots and lots of different ways to do it. And actually the different methodologies do different things. It's pretty wide ranging in the way it's cultivated. And I think one of the big things that we're trying to do with Seagreen is to improve these methodologies to get the most out of the seaweed. And we want to spread that message globally. And yeah, it's not as easy as just, you know, as like I said, pick an area of sea. There's more to it than that. And really that's why we're doing what we do. We want people to understand that this can be turned into a truly economically viable crop. And it's something you can get a lot out of in different ways. And when we were talking earlier about the plastic question, there's another use that we probably haven't mentioned yet, but seaweed can also be used to make plastic. It can be used to make bioplastic.
Oh, wow.
One of the important things is getting the microplastics, so these really tiny strands of plastic out of the seaweed when you're harvesting it for these existing commercial crops. But we're also looking into the possibility of using the seaweed itself to be the plastic that we want to replace in the environment. So if we can get away from this disposable culture of using, you know, single-use plastic cutlery or single-use straws and start using the seaweed, that's going to be huge demand that people are going to want to meet.
You know, I'm sitting here and I'm looking and I'm going to share some images online. But this seaweed farming thing, I'm just getting, you know, I'm kind of excited here. You're talking about, now, mind you, all I can do is walk in water and I'm a great floater. So obviously I'm going to have to start a business and hire people. But this idea of seaweed farming is very interesting. Dr. Delavo, your thoughts on it? I mean, I'm just thinking where would we do this? And, you know, and Fred, I'll come back to you on another note on in terms of if you're talking about 220,000 people, that means we can halfway stop fishing out our conch. Can I make money from this? Like I'm all kinds of different places now. Dr. Delavo, your thoughts?
Certainly there's a large international market for it. I mean, it's one of marine seaweed growing is one of the fastest growing areas of aquaculture there is right now. The Bahamas, an archipelago, as you said, country of 700 islands, we cover a tremendous area of marine seabed. And so there is space available. Now, I wouldn't think of doing it in Nassau, really, because there is crowded. There's land is of, especially coastal land, is quite valuable in Nassau. However, in virtually any other family island, they have stretches and stretches of basically uninhabited areas where a farmer can go and set up without being a disturbance to navigation or someone else's recreational site or some fisherman's dive place. You know, there's lots of areas where a farmer could go and with the proper protocols in place, establish a farm. With marine farming, there are little in forms, and especially for seaweed, there's very little in forms of waste. Once you have proper management on the site, I mean, your inputs are basically minimal and you take out what you put in. And so your pollution aspects, your hazard are minimal. So given time and care and with, you know, knowledge, this can be a quite lucrative business.
Go ahead, Ash.
One of the things we want to consider is a behavior change for Bahamians to understand the nutritional values and how do we start incorporating that. There's the commercial side, yes, for pharmaceutical and industrial purposes, but now how can we incorporate the seaweed into the Bahamian diet, into the Bahamian food chain, if you will, and come up with seaweed lemonade and seaweed conch salad, you know, and I've never thought of
this. Call it an aphrodisiac.
you best believe it. We would have a seaweed cook-off, seaweed competitions, seaweed tasting. Yes. Call it an aphrodisiac, for God's sake.
Yes.
So Dr. Delamore knows the baby.
Part of that growth strategy will also be for Bahamians to understand and see the nutritional and the food security values. That's an important factor.
Yeah, no, Fred, let me go to you. Sorry. And my mind is racing. I'm thinking now because I'm saying, okay, well, what is the startup cost for something like this? Dr. Delavaux hinted that obviously we're probably not talking about New Providence, some of these family islands, but we have these are sea-bearing things. So hurricanes shouldn't matter, eh? Like, it shouldn't be an issue. But Fred, what do you think?
Well, it isn't a simple question in terms of like a single number, although certain organizations have tried to put numbers on it. There's a quite well-known cooperative organization in North America that's working to get people growing seaweed commercially. And they say that all you need is a few hectares of ocean. I think they say $10,000 in a boat. And that's quite a lot of money. But if you're looking at a much more kind of artisanal level, you really don't need very much to get started. And the best way to do that is in cooperation with each other. And that's the really, really powerful thing about aquaculture for coastal communities, is this is something that you can do with other people and you can share in the profits. There's a lot of jobs involved in seaweed growing. We think that from our research, it's about 9 to 13 jobs per farmer beyond Wow. just the person doing the seaweed. So in some ways, it's a really, really important thing to think of, not just in terms of the capital investment required, but also all the stuff you're getting out of it. You mentioned earlier, obviously, this idea, Dr. Delavaux, about going to a clean area of the coast where there's no fishing going on. But actually, seaweed can be used as part of an integrated approach to aquaculture, a thing called integrated multitrophic aquaculture, which is where effectively you use more than one kind of produce to support each other. So two really good examples would be putting seaweed around or in fish farms, or indeed around a commercial fishing operation, to enhance the local fishing or local fisheries population, as it were, or the local population of fish, and to improve catch, or to use something like mussels or oysters in the same cultivation zones. And those things feed off each other. So you create vertical farms within the ocean. You use the entire space from the top of the surface all the way down to the shore or to the sea bottom. And that means you're being very, very efficient in terms of how you use your space, and you get multiple revenue streams. So you're talking about things like selling oysters at premium prices, but also selling the seaweed. And that seaweed can be made into so many different things, which is fantastic as a commercial opportunity. And then we look at other options like around Singapore. Obviously, you mentioned earlier, Nahaja, that it's a developed country, but it's quite small. There's not much coastline. And mm-hmm. Singapore is known as a very, very important shipping destination. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that means that the shipping effluent that comes out of these big boats is pretty damaging to the local area. And that means that sometimes you can end up with a situation where the entire nutrient value of the sea is gone. And mm-hmm. what they're looking into at the moment, and we're helping to support, is this idea of using the seaweed to clean up the water. And that itself gives you more options in terms of your natural capital. So this is things like making sure that your coral reefs are still all safe and healthy. And that itself regenerates the ocean and allows us to live in harmony, but also use what it's providing for our commercial benefit. So it's about, as you say, as you mentioned, kind of a behavior change. Yes, that means eating seaweed, but it also means thinking about how we work with nature and how we work efficiently with nature to support our economies and the ocean itself.
Yeah, you know, it's going to be one of those interesting and powerful opportunities there where I'm seeing to myself, okay, we can do this. We can do this, right? Dr. Delavaux, you're the man at BAMC, yeah? Yes. How ready are we to do this? This is when you start throwing the heavy questions to the folks with the answers.
Well, I'll start off. BAMC, this is one of the reasons BAMC exists. The whole idea of BAMC came about was to, it's not people think of BAMC as being a farm, but we're basically an advisory agent to the government in terms of agriculture and marine science. One of the things we do specifically is to, we're a tertiary institution. So we're trying to train the replacements of farmers and fishermen to come in to I mean, the average farmer in the Bahamas is 60 to 70 years old now. So one of the things we want to do is create a new cadre of young entrepreneurs, young farmers trained in modern techniques, modern ways to run a business, run their fishing, their farming businesses. So that's one of the things BAMSI is all about. So we're training, not change, we're also changing the way they think about it, of their business, whether it's fishing or farming, or agriculture, or mariculture, or aquaculture, or aquaponics, or hydroponics. Any one of those, we can offer training in that. So that's the start of getting a mindset change, the education involved, and you can. That's what BAMSI's purpose is. We grow products based on import substitution. So we look at the products that are primarily imported into the country, food products. And those are the top items we grow at BAMSI to try reduce our foreign exchange expenditures out of the country, reduce those foreign expenditures. So again, that's one of the purposes of BAMSI. So there are many things we can do here to start off with. Now, for aquaculture and mariculture of seaweeds, again, as Fred said, it's not that difficult and not many resources are required. But when I refer to competition, not competition per se, with fishing, in the Bahamas, we must understand there are some things. The Bahamas is a nation of demersal fisheries. We don't really have a lot of pelagic fisheries. And so a lot of the current crop of fishermen may look at aquaculture in the coastal zone as an interference, as a problem, as a thing. So we have to, again, educate them to realize that this can be beneficial to them. Yes, it can be that way, but we have to change their mindsets as well. And then also we have to consider that our biggest business in the Bahamas is tourism. Mm-hmm. Tourists come to the Bahamas because we have clean beaches, clear waters. The idea of clear waters is almost the opposite of what you need for good aquaculture, mariculture businesses. The clear waters, what we call oligotrophic waters, are a symbol that there's very little in terms of nutrients in the waters. Hmm. So with poor nutrients, it'll be virtually impossible to have an oyster fishery develop, for example, because the mussels, the oysters that we can grow here would have to be fed, supplemented, because it's not naturally available. We have the largest oysters you probably would find in the Bahamas is on the order of a couple millimeters that naturally occurs. So, and we kind of hesitant to be importing products that aren't native, because we've seen the impact of that with invasive species coming in. So that's another problem we want to avoid as far as possible. I'm sure the conservation groups would have their say in terms of what we allowed to bring in and what would be allowed to produce, to grow agriculture business, mariculture business. So, I mean, there are a lot of factors to be considered. It isn't just, this is a good idea, but it has to fit and work in our environment under our circumstances. And so everyone, it's a question of balance. It's a question of balance. What can be done in a sustainable, that can earn income, that can employ people? And that's what it's all about. You have to get that balance in place that everybody works. But on the whole, certainly sargassum grows in the Bahamas, and certainly farming it can certainly be a benefit. And especially, I just, just in Nassau, around New Providence, the coastline is virtually all used.
Yeah.
And so to develop, that's why I suggested a family island of Andros, fifth largest island in the Caribbean with about 8,000 people.
Yeah. Well, that's where I was going. I was going to park up right next to Prescott's Lodge. I don't know if you ever met Prescott, Fred, but I was going to park up. There's a guy there, and he has a great lodge and a bunch of space, and shrimp comes to the shore, just come up to be axe beaten. I'm going there.
And the fishery and aquaculture farm would assist with the shrimp production, increase the shrimp that would come in. So it's a benefit, So see, that's a lot of things. There are benefits on both sides all around.
Let's see, now you're talking. See, my plan is working out, gentlemen. So my lodge is going to be legitimately awesome, and Fred can come and visit and help me plant all of my wonderful seaweed. Okay, so startup costs, right? The startup costs of something like this per individual. So you see, you talk, Fred, about 220,000 people in India. You did say India. It was India, right?
Indonesia.
Startup cost is like what per person, per family?
It's I think, you know, again, it doesn't translate well across economies, I think. And Indonesia itself is very, very focused on subsidizing these economies. But we're talking in the very, very low ranges. It doesn't cost much to get these farms started per individual. They're very much artisanal businesses. They're designed to support local communities. And I'm hesitating to put a specific number on it because, as you said, Dr. Delavaux, each operation has to be specific to its location. Mm-hmm. We want to be really careful that we as Seagreen are recommending the right kind of aquaculture and the right kind of seaweed farming. And that means different species. Now, one of the advantages of our platform as Seagreen, and indeed our organizations on the ground, is that we can look at those specific use cases. And I'm so glad, Dr. Delavaux, that you mentioned that, because my colleague who works in our sustainability department would be very upset with me if I had said to you, just go and grow whatever you want, wherever you want to, because it's important that you think carefully about the unique situation of your local community. And in the Bahamas, that's obviously very different to Indonesia. And I know, appreciate, obviously, there's a similarity. There's a lot of islands. It's a similar coastal environment. But the key element of what we're trying to do at Seagreen is to think of models that support the environment and that support the individuals together. So what would be really, really fantastic, and Aj has already kind of alluded to the potential of the Bahamas, is to be able to give people in the Bahamians, normal Bahamians, the opportunity to group together and create these local organizations that support each other in starting seaweed cultivation. And this can be in cooperation with local fisheries, local tourism. Actually, that will help. The seaweed will help with that. It's a very, very good restorer of environmental or local environments. So I think the kind of key message here is that what we're trying to do is to build a platform, a technology platform that can support Bahamians in doing this. And it's not just about the technology in some ways. Whilst we expect this to be very much available to people on their phones, and we want to help them to grow these operations themselves to get into seaweed farming, it's much more than just a mobile application. It's not just something that we say, here, download this and go and grow some seaweed. We're all about helping out as well. A big part of our operation is looking at the unique circumstances for a seaweed farm and helping people to understand what's going to work in their situation. It's about training and delivering these programs to people through their mobile phones, but also directly with, on-spot assistance through remote connection, if possible, or if necessary. And then it's also about supporting people to find buyers for the seaweed on the far end of the
which is great,
chain, which is a very important part. Yeah, it's absolutely critical. And then finally, the other important piece is to make sure that people like Dr. Delavaux, other scientists, academic partners, organizations globally like the UN, the FAO, the Food and Agriculture Organization, have the ability to see this data that we're producing by having these applications to support these businesses. Because traceability is a hugely important part of all this stuff that we're doing. Understanding where these products come from, being able to say this seaweed was grown here, was harvested this way, it was dried in this way, and then it went to this place to be transported to here and turned into this product. So that piece is hugely powerful in terms of the data, and we're really excited to be able to make that available to the scientific and development community as well.
It's amazing how quickly time has gone, and I'm sitting here and I'm vexed, right? Because I still have more questions. Dr. Delavaux, I have like tons of questions for you. Let me see if I can get, no, I can't even squeeze it in. All I'm thinking is the technical, you know what, screw it, but figure it out on the other end. let me ask you, Dr. Delavaux, before I let you guys go, looking at, the layout of the land, right? Looking at the layout of the land, the science, the data, all of the things that are driven that we use to determine what can happen, what can't happen. If you are looking at the health of our seas, our waters and whatnot, and you mentioned that, you know, for certain areas, certain things can happen. You know, we need darker seas for certain growth and whatnot. Is there any particular island in your mind right now where you could say, well, you know what? I think this is a venture that we can do here, but I would, you know, and I gather you would need more time to figure out how many people can get into this type of business, the effects of it. But any particular island stands out as a place or a space that might be good for this type of venture?
Off the top of my head, I just thinking about the conditions that would be required to have a safe, efficient operation. Seaweed cultivation is carried out. You might need a depth of less 2 feet or so. So somewhere near shore that is sheltered, where storm surge may be abated if it comes in. You'd want some deep water nearby to bring in nutrients from the deeper areas off. There are certain conditions that would have to be met, but most of our islands would do, I would think, off the top of my head. I mean, Andres with a shallow bank all around, especially on the west side. On the east side, where it gets deeper more rapidly, you know, when you just go off and then you fall off into the tongue of the ocean, mm-hmm. You know, we'd have to look carefully at to choose a specific site that meets certain parameters, you know, with water flow, with currents, with temperature, with stability, you know, sediment, all of that would have to be considered. And where there's community close by, it is a good employment opportunity, certainly. A person is starting and start have people working with them, because it can be a small operation, as little as a 2-3 man operation, but when it comes to harvesting on any scale, you need additional help. So yeah. You know, it can be quite a useful thing in many areas. But I'd say experiment. I'd say, look, let a scientist take a look at the area, the conditions that exist, and make a recommendation. Should be all good then. I think it's a great opportunity. And we have lots of experience we can turn to in the rest of the Caribbean. So Barbados, St. Lucia, Jamaica, this has been done. We can look at the conditions there. We can learn from them and try not to repeat the mistakes they have made over time. And, you know, just we can cherry pick the best opportunities, the best examples. They're available. It's just a matter of bringing someone in or getting FAO to, you know, write a grant to investigate, you know. It's been done and funded by multiple agencies. Training opportunities are available, or you can simply go and visit a farm, you know, that exists already.
You know, gentlemen, I will tell you this was very enlightening. I'm very intrigued, and this is just one of those other things. Like, that's what gets me excited, right? Dr. Delavaux, you don't understand. We have to meet in person, because you are, I don't even know how, are you an Andres or are you here?
I'm an Andres.
You're an Andres. That's the best island to be on. I want the best place in all of the world, except for Exuma. Sorry, Fred. I'm sure that UK is nice too. I'm just going to throw that.
Nahaja, I just want to throw in to follow up with Dr. Delavaux. The foundation understands this new area, and we strategically are planning to be the anchor to explore the viability or feasibility study around the seaweed industry, working with various organizations and international as well as local and other organizations to really look at long term what does that look like, and how do we transition from feasibility to economic to actual business model. So we have Fred and Dr. Delavaux and others from other organizations that will be part of that conversation. And this is the first part of that journey, really to bring the Bahamian people to the light of what the opportunity that exists, especially in this current economic period when we're looking for diversification of our economy.
Yeah. Gentlemen, thank you all so much for your time. Thank you for your expertise and for lending it to the show today. And I think a lot of people have really learned a lot. And hopefully we're intrigued, we're excited, and are looking at all of the other opportunities that the planet has given us, where we can do things that will sustain it, not end it, and also create for ourselves personal economic freedom. So I thank you guys so much. Fred Puckle, ladies and gentlemen, Fred Puckle Hobbs, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Delavaux, Ash Cunningham, gentlemen, thank you again. You are listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black right here on Guardian 96.9 FM. Everyone, have a wonderful day. I'm excited. I hope you're excited. This is what our environment can do. This is what the Bahamas Natural Resources Foundation is all about. And of course, this is why you listen to The Hit Back, because this is how we roll. We want you to be empowered every day, all the time. We are here to make a difference in this country. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM.